already underway.
Thank you very much. That concludes questions this afternoon. And we now turn to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15766 in the name of Jenny Mara on health. Can I invite members who wish to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons now, please? And I call on Jenny Mara to speak to and move the motion. Ms Mara, 14 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Let me start this debate this afternoon by recognising and thanking NHS staff up and down this country for the tireless and the professional job that they do in caring for our sick and vulnerable people in communities, surgeries and hospitals the length and breadth of this country. It is the way we should start every health debate, because our staff are, as we know, the backbone of our NHS. We are proud of them, support them, and we thank them for their work. But, Presiding Officer, they need more than thanks and appreciation. They need the resources to allow them to deliver the high-quality local services that people expect and demand. And that is where we as politicians enter the fray, Presiding Officer. While our NHS staff and other public servants today work away tirelessly, we debate the funding challenges, the fiscal options and the political decisions which can enable or inhibit them from doing their job. And with the fiscal framework for the new tax powers now agreed, we know that the powers we have long anticipated will soon be transferred, and with a good financial deal behind them, we have the potential to truly bring about change. But it poses serious questions for us. It poses the questions of what kind of nation do we want to be? One that rightly demands better public services and is prepared to pay for them, or one that rightly demands better public services but finds excuses not to pay for them or deliver them. Presiding Officer, today a consensus has emerged among the Scottish political parties, which only the Conservatives break from. With Nicola Sturgeon's announcement on the council tax, we now all agree that if we want better public services, we need to be brave enough to ask people to pay for them. Labour, Liberals, yes.
Jackson Carlow.
So I'm bewildered. The announcement by the Scottish Government today on council tax reform is exactly the proposal which the Scottish Conservatives made last month when our tax commission reported. It doesn't pick up any of the options of the commission in which she was a part, but actually echoes the very proposals we made. So if she's looking for a consensus, it certainly exists on this side.
Jenny Jackson Carlow for his intervention. I was more implying his disagreement with our proposal on the one pence on income tax. But if I can make a bit of progress, Labour, Liberals and now the SNP have made education a priority for any additional revenue, for right and for proper reasons. But given the challenges and problems in our health service, are we spending enough on our NHS and care services? And the evidence before us would perhaps suggest not. Now, we all share a starting point that health spending should be protected by the Scottish budget. Scottish Parliament spends one third of the budget on our health service, a considerable sum, but we still face persistent and seemingly intransigent problems with ill health, poverty and disease in Scotland. Every MSP in this chamber, I am sure, is being told in their local area that their GP surgery is struggling to recruit doctors, Presiding Officer. Lists being closed to patients, health boards stepping in to run general practice, and the experts telling us that the very existence of general practice is under threat. In my home city of Dundee, we have a doctor's surgery in one of the most deprived communities in Scotland, teetering on the brink of survival, as the recruitment crisis strangles GP provision, threatening the very existence of that GP practice in the local area. Now, recruitment is a huge challenge which health boards and the government is grappling with at the moment. Posts across the country remain unfilled, many for months, with no signs of being filled in the near future, and services are having to be altered to ensure patient safety as a result. The cut in university training places for doctors from this government is coming home to roost in our health service. It was a short-sighted decision. and I hope that mistake will not be made again. We have a huge number of doctors training in this country and then leaving to go abroad, and no guarantees that the increased trend in this will follow previous years, trends in previous years gone by of doctors returning to our shores to serve the NHS. This is one of the biggest recruitment challenges, and we'll need some clever thinking over the next Parliament, as we all know the effect it is having on our local services. Presiding Officer, it is now a full year since Shona Robson made the pledge to abolish delayed discharge from our hospitals within that year. Sadly, she has not been able to achieve that. And according to the statistics released a couple of weeks ago, there has been a welcome improvement in A&E waiting times, but we still see more than 50 patients waiting more than 8 hours at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow. We have seen an increase... Yes.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. She talks about hospitals and she talks about local services. Does she think we need to have a shift in health spending towards more preventative, and including GP services, and perhaps fewer resources going into acute and hospitals?
Jenny Manor.
We have had a debate in this chamber before about shift to preventative service, but the crux of this is about services being delivered locally and that preventative approach being integrated. If John Mason will allow me to return, I was talking about the statistics released by the Scottish Government a couple of weeks ago. We have seen an increase in operations cancelled for non-clinical or capacity reasons, which was addressed at health questions this afternoon. We have seen missed targets for adults starting psychological therapies, and only 70% of children, and this is a really important point, and young people have started mental health treatment compared to the government's own target of 90%, which is very worrying. Presiding Officer, health boards across the country are facing millions of pounds worth of cuts or savings, with my own health board seeking to save 27 million costs over the next couple of years due to rises in agency nursing costs. I know the Cabinet Secretary knows about this, and through primary care prescribing. Huge savings, with the real impact yet to be felt. Presiding Officer, we can all agree that we face many challenges in our health and care service, and our NHS staff are doing a fantastic job in difficult and pressing circumstances. But the pressure on staff and our NHS is only set to grow. And what else will give unless we find additional revenue and resource? Many of my colleagues, Presiding Officer, from across Scotland sit waiting for decisions on services in their local areas. Big question marks fall over services in Lightburn Hospital in Glasgow and St John's Hospital in Livingston, and many other local wards and services. The injustice of these question marks, and the reason we bring this to the Cabinet Secretary today, is that it is simply not fair that these questions persistently hang in the air. And it is certainly not fair that these question marks hang in the air until after the election in May. Honest governments, I believe, will make decisions that are in the best interests of people and work with them to manage any change that that decision brings. But they should have the courage of their convictions and the confidence of their argument. But it is not right that all of these crucial decisions are left in the balance because the government does not want to be asked any difficult questions or face any opposition from local groups before the election in May. Presiding Officer, I expect this afternoon's debate could be more highly charged than usual. And let me explain why I think this will be so. Because when there is doubt over local services, people need their representatives to stand with them and represent their concerns. Now, there has been a lot of discussions in early Hustings meetings and in panel meetings between the four main parties about taking politics out of the health debate. And Jackson Carlaw is a particularly strong proponent of this, which, if I may poke a bit of fun at him, Presiding Officer, is an interesting current position for a Conservative health spokesperson, given the political hot water Jeremy Hunt finds himself in England. Joanne Lamont made a similar argument not too long ago And I think that mostly has worked well. There is general consensus across this chamber about what needs to be done in the future. The integration of health and social care, a move away from acute, more preventative services based around primary care, expanded roles from pharmacy around primary care, increased involvement of allied health professionals, and a much needed focus on preventative health policies and public health. And we had a good debate in June last year, where we said that we will support government where we agree and where consensus to make progress is required, and we will hold them to account where necessary. That is our job and our democratic duty. But where there is change proposed, and especially where there is uncertainty, people in their communities need the representatives to stand with them shoulder to shoulder to represent them through that change, or to ask questions to power on what that change is, why that change is happening, and why they do not have the information they need. Especially where there is uncertainty, there is a danger that rumour and myth fill the void, and that is something that good government should do its best to avoid. And it is this basic right, Presiding Officer, that brings us to the chamber today, because it has simply been abused, and I do not use that word lightly, in some of the instances you will hear about from my colleagues this afternoon. Decisions that have been on the cards for months and have been delayed and delayed with no good reason, which can only lead us to the conclusion that they are being delayed until the votes have been counted and the truth remains hidden until any electoral consequence is safely passed. Presiding Officer, I do not think that is a fair and honest way to run the country or our health service, and the Scottish people deserve honest government. It is not just decisions on provision of local services, as detailed in today's motion, that have been on hold. The cancer strategy, which we have raised in this chamber several times before, is months overdue. Even the Tories in England managed to publish theirs last summer, when both were due, with commendable measures on diagnosis, care and treatment, but we still wait for our cancer strategy in Scotland, not far off a year delayed. The Cabinet Secretary has said that the national conversation has to complete, but the cancer strategy was due for publication before she came up with the national conversation, so it is no good reason for its delay. I sincerely hope we will see a strategy published this side of the election, so people can see it before they cast their votes. And that is the crux of this, Presiding Officer, that people have the information they need on the intention of their own government on their local services, the most simple democratic transaction. The Scottish Government has a choice. Will they be brave enough in the future to ask the people of Scotland to pay more for quality local services, or will they be honest today that they plan to cut these local services after the election? Will the Government allow the people of Scotland to make a judgment on their record and vision for the health services and these very specific decisions, or will they try to sneak through the next few weeks without making the hard decisions and expressing their intentions, only to spring them on people after their votes have been cast? I would think that would be a very unfair way to proceed, and I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will be able to provide us with clarity on that today. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name.
Many thanks. And I now call on Shona Robison to speak to and move Amendment 157.66.1. Cabinet Secretary, 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very happy to take part in this debate today. It provides a timely opportunity to acknowledge the commitment and dedication of health and social care staff across the whole of Scotland, to reflect on our record and performance, which I'm very happy to put in front of the Scottish people in the next few weeks. Very happy indeed. And to, of course, comment on the actions being taken to ensure that Scotland's NHS continues to be the world-class service that it is. The budget for 2016-17, agreed by Parliament last week, confirms that health spending in Scotland will rise to a record level of close to £13 billion. This government has increased the health resource budget by 6.8% in real terms between 2010-11 and 2016-17, and will continue to provide real terms protection. As I confirmed last week, in 2016-17, more than £500 million of additional funding has been allocated to Scotland's health boards, with a 5.5% increase in territorial boards' budget levels. This funding includes investment of an additional £250 million to support the integration of health and social care and to build the capacity of community-based services, something, of course, which the Labour Party asked us to do in a previous debate in this place. Yes, of course.
Alec Rowley. Could I have Alec Rowley's microphone, please?
In my constituency in Lough Ellyr, the Scythe and Benarte, they are unable to recruit GPs. That's true in Glenrothes, Leith and Methil, right across Fife. So in terms of primary care and investment in social care, if we don't have the GPs, then we have a real problem. Is she not worried about that?
Cabinet Secretary, well, we do have time for the interventions. I can give
And of course, that's why we are going to be investing the additional £85 million over the next 3 years to ensure that we help primary care to develop and overcome some of the recruitment and retention problems that Alec Rowley has highlighted. The unprecedented funding that I've just mentioned is matched, of course, with a record level of NHS staffing, with over 8.9% more staff now than in 2006. We have record high numbers of qualified nurses and midwives. We have, over the same period, increased the number of medical and dental consultants by 41.8%, and vacancy levels are down. So, you know, this government will continue to work with the professions. Just let me make some progress. We'll continue to work with the professions to support staff across the NHS in adopting improved clinical practices to deliver world-class services. Health and social care staff should also be applauded for the 18% reduction in delayed discharge in December 2015 compared to the year before, and a huge improvement in performance in our A&E departments compared to last winter. So these are real achievements to be celebrated. However, there, of course, is much more to be done. We recognise the demographic changes and other risks, just a minute, and have to be prepared for those challenges. Our recently launched National Clinical Strategy has shown how we can adapt our services to meet these challenges and ensure that we get the best possible value for patients from the resource invested in the NHS. This ambitious strategy, a blueprint really for the next 10 to 15 years, describes the rationale for patient-centred and stronger whole system integrated primary, social and secondary care delivery across Scotland, delivered by locally responsive and increasingly multidisciplinary teams. In primary and community care, we now move forward to build capacity and provide a more broadly based mix of professionals around our GP practices and our health centres. For hospital care, we've achieved much in recent years in streamlining patient journeys. In a minute, we have achieved much in recent years in streamlining patient journeys within hospitals. However, more needs to be done, and we now need to move on to ensure that once patients have undergone treatment and their condition is stable, they're discharged with appropriate support as soon as possible. Once they're home, they'll be supported by strengthened primary and community care teams. Yes.
Neil Bibby.
The Cabinet Secretary is talking about resources and protecting the NHS budget. NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde have said they need to find over £1 million a week in savings over the next financial year. Can she confirm that is accurate?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Greater Glasgow and Clyde's budget has increased to a level unprecedented previously, along with every other board. But along with every other board, they have to make efficiencies. They have already delivered efficiencies of 3% in previous years, all of which are invested back into frontline services within those board areas. So we'll continue to invest the levels of unprecedented resources to the health service, and we expect our boards to deliver the frontline services for that. Underpinning the clinical strategy is our long-term commitment to secure and develop local services where possible and specialised services where necessary. This will ensure that our health and social care services are responsive to the ever-changing needs of the population. And of course, the integration of health and social care is one of the most significant reforms since the establishment of the NHS. Presiding Officer, I noted with interest that Labour's motion calls on all parties to ensure the continuation of current services at a range of hospitals. And I think there is a lack of self-awareness in Labour's ranks. They should reflect on what Labour actually did for hospitals when in power, and then compare that with what we have delivered. We shouldn't forget that the very first act of Nicola Sturgeon as Health Secretary on the 6th of June 2007, when she came to Parliament and announced that we were overturning the previous Labour-led administration's decision to close the highly valued A&E departments at Monklands and Ayr hospitals. And while we've been consistent in our belief that the decisions of our predecessors to close these A&E departments were wrong, we recognise the need for a robust evidence base to ensure that services would be sustainable and to repair the trust and confidence which had been so damaged with local communities. And in such... Wait, no, not just now. And as such, we are, I have taken two. As such, we commissioned independent scrutiny of the options, a process established and used three times since we came into power, and still available to help inform major service change considerations. The experts of that independent scrutiny panel emphatically confirmed our position to be correct. The fact that the previous administration, notwithstanding the lack of a clear and robust evidence base, was prepared to sanction the closure of these A&E units beggars belief. And what would the impact of that been? Well, since our decision to save these units, they've provided much needed emergency capacity, seeing some 830,000 attendances between them. And we've not just maintained these departments, we've invested in them and enhanced them. I was also interested to note how Labour's motion specifically calls for the retention of emergency care services at the Vale of Leven Hospital. Interested because the A&E department at the Vale actually closed in 2002 under the previous Labour-led administration. Indeed, it was this government that ended a decade of damaging uncertainty by approving the vision for the Vale in 2009, thereby securing its remaining emergency services alongside the provision of local maternity services and the repatriation of a number of specialties. With regards to Lightburn, I've been clear, as I said, in health portfolio questions that there would need to be a material change to the position in 2011 when Nicola Sturgeon, as Health Secretary, ruled out the closing of the hospital based on the proposal that came to her. And we've continued to invest in St John's, a list of investments never made under the previous Labour administration. Lots of investment in St John's and, of course, the independent review of paediatric services, which has been undertaken across Lothian, will report to NHS Lothian in due course. I'll take Neil Finlay.
Neil Finlay.
The Cabinet Secretary is referring to the previous Cabinet Secretary who said who took decisions to stop closures. She could take a decision now to stop any detriment to the children's ward at St John's. But we know why she won't, because she intervened, as did her officials, to bump the words that the NHS Lothian use, bump the review until after the election.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, let's be clear, there are no proposals for closure of any of these services mentioned in the motion. None of them have come to me or indeed have even been approved for closure by any of the local boards themselves. None of them. None of them, not at all. Unlike, of course, the record of the previous administration. So you'll understand, Presiding Officer, why we feel very confident in comparing our record on safeguarding these key local services with that of the Labour Party, because actions speak louder than words. This government has not only adopted a rigorous evidence-based approach to developing health policy, we've also been consistent in ensuring the full involvement and engagement of service users and local communities throughout. We have a coherent plan in the National Clinical Strategy and, of course, the national conversation launched last August seeks public views on these ideas and asks them what their priorities are. I would just contrast this, presiding officer, with the ragtag and bobtail motion written clearly on the back of a fag packet, which has more to do with trying to save the seats of a number of Labour MSPs and has nothing to do with wanting to protect vital local services. Labour have no coherent health policy, bereft of ideas, nothing to offer the Scottish people. The paucity of their motion demonstrates that, and I'm very pleased to move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. And to now call in Jackson Carlaw. 6 minutes or so, Mr. Carlaw.
Thank you, presiding officer. I mean, it occurs to me that looking at the timetable for the rest of this parliament, that this may very well prove to be the last full general debate that we have on health. And I want to make the observation that before my time, we benefited from the experience of Sam Galbraith, and in my time, from the benefit of Dr. Ian McKee, from Dr. Richard Simpson, and from Dr. Nanette Milne. And I do think that the Parliament will be the poorer for the fact that when we meet in the next session, and I don't know the CVs of all those potential new MSPs who may be coming, but I do think it looks like we are likely to be bereft of actually those who have had frontline experience within the NHS as medical practitioners, and I regret that. So I do want to begin, before I thank the staff, for thanking those MSPs who have contributed to the life of this Parliament with a fundamental understanding of the service that they have had before. I join Jenny Mara in the tribute to the staff, and you know, I don't demur from the fact that it is worthwhile for us to do that and to start many of the debates we have on health with that tribute. I have observed before, though, that it's very much a conceit amongst us here in this chamber that there will be health professionals all over Scotland who are currently sitting watching the deliberations that we are currently having. Most of them are so very busy in the jobs that they are doing under such enormous pressure in the environments that they are in, that I should think at times they find our thanks somewhat hollow. I mean, they are meant sincerely, but of course they are dependent upon us responding, I think, to what they are saying. And although Jenny Mara set up a couple of straw men, I think, there to try and disarm me, I've made perfectly clear before that this Conservative Party now has no truck with the health reforms that are taking place, which were begun by Tony Blair in 1999, continued by the coalition government and pursued by the Conservative government there. The health services of Northern Ireland, of Wales, of Scotland and of England may be called the National Health Service, but in every other sense, they have diverged in their own particular way. And here in Scotland, we are all committed in this Parliament to a National Health Service in public hands, free at the point of need and delivery. And the debate that I have very much hoped that we can move towards is how do we create a sustainable NHS which will secure that model of healthcare into the future, which is the one we all want to see pursued. Now, the difficulty, and I actually thought Jenny Mara moved the motion in slightly more measured tones than I feared she might, because I welcome the fact that after the general election, where nationally the Labour Party, I think, did use the NHS again in the hope that it would influence the outcome, they came to this chamber and said they too wish to participate in a non-partisan approach to the development of health in Scotland. And I have said to the Cabinet Secretary, yes, I would like to see the health taken out of politics. It's not quite the same thing as taking politics out of health, because this Parliament and all the representatives in it have a duty to pursue the day-to-day management of the health service and the critical issues that arise, even while we seek to work collectively with the government to agree that broader national consensus going forward. And it doesn't matter what group of health professionals I meet, whether it's the BMA, whether it's the RCN, whether it's the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, whether it's allied healthcare professionals, whoever they are saying the same thing. We, they say as professionals, acknowledge the enormous challenge that is now presented to the health service in Scotland through conditions, some of which were not even in place when this Parliament first met, and which are potentially undermining our ability to maintain the kind of health service in Scotland that we want to see. So please, can you as politicians find some way to work together to ensure that that national strategy, which secures the future of the health service, enjoys all party support? And I've also said to the Cabinet Secretary, that's not the same thing As the Cabinet Secretary announcing something and then expecting a cross-party consensus that underpins that announcement? It requires us to find a way of ensuring that all of the political parties, as well as the broader stakeholders, are participative in the work that brings about the agreement of what that strategy will be. Now, I actually think this is an excellent document, the National Clinical Strategy for Scotland. But in its executive summary, it is candid, because it states that it is something of a higher level review of what needs to be done and the shape of healthcare in Scotland that we need to see evolve, without getting into the detail and the nitty-gritty on some of what will prove to be the very difficult decisions that will have to be taken if that strategy is to be secured. So I don't... Yes, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course, what we would expect is for local boards, not just individually, but working with each other, and you'll notice regional planning is a key part of this, will apply the principles of this to their local services, and that's what we would expect to happen in the next phase of the strategy.
Jackson Carlin.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for this. Now, I'll conclude in my opening remarks by saying this. When we as a party took the view that we wanted to participate in trying to achieve a consensus, we recognised that that will mean that the next Parliament will require to take some difficult decisions. Do we in this election use that potential agenda of difficult decisions as a political football, or do we stand back and accept that it will require a degree of courage in the next Parliament and for government to know that it has a broader level of support? If the government can consult with the other parties and involve us in the decisions that have to be taken, then we continue to take the view that in this election, health must be removed from that political debate, and only a constructive approach must be the one that we follow. And we commit in the election to maintaining a constructive approach in how we deliver that sustainable model of health in the next Parliament.
Many thanks. We now turn to the open debate. Could I ask all members who intend to participate in this debate to press the request to speak buttons, please? And I call on Bob Doris to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Speeches of 6 minutes or so, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. On Monday, I visited a new £12 million health and social care centre that's nearing completion in Maryhill. The Scottish Government has invested substantially in the new centre, as it has in the NHS more generally, with this year alone a record £13 billion annual budget across Scotland, representing a substantial real terms increase. Likewise, there are record numbers of staff, 9% higher under this SNP government, 11,000 overall, including 2,500 additional nurses and midwives. Another important achievement has been the increase in A&E consultants, for example, an eye-watering 168%. Are there still challenges? Well, of course they are, and those challenges are substantial. With a significantly growing elderly population, with increasing frailties and multi-morbidities, how could it be otherwise? Surely to goodness we could all agree on that, irrespective of who is in charge of Scotland's NHS. Indeed, when I mentioned record staffing levels in Scotland about Scotland's NHS yesterday to a constituent of mine, he was quick to remind me of those significant pressures still faced by our nurses, indeed with my wife, who is also a nurse. But this constituent was right to do so. And it's reasonable to say that although the Scottish Government and Scotland's NHS are under substantial challenges, we're approaching those challenges from a position of strength. And I think we should all be able to agree on that, rather than the road of scaremongering and fear tactics that I think we've heard a little bit in the opening contribution by Jenny Mara. So I'm pleased that the Scottish Government has stated that it is committed, and I quote, it is committed to maintaining and improving safe and effective local services. I'm making a contribution if you'd sit down just now, Mr Martin. I'm pleased that the Scottish Government has stated in its amendment that it is committed to maintaining and improving safe and effective local services across Scotland, including in the Royal Alexander Hospital, Vale of Leven Hospital, Lightburn Hospital and St John's Hospital. That's there in black and white in the amendment before us. I hope that halts in its tracks any debate this afternoon, although I hear my doubts about whether the Scottish Government is going to axe these facilities. We are clearly not. That commitment had already been made, and it's reiterated again today. I'll resist the temptation, although my colleagues may not, to open up the debate about track records in relation to accessing services that the community values. I believe this Scottish Government's record, as laid out by the Cabinet Secretary for Health, is rather better than the last Scottish Executive that mismanaged Scotland's NHS for a number of years. Now, I'd like to look at some of the challenges we face in context. And yes, there has been successes along the way. So we have a real challenge in relation to delayed discharge. Of course we do. Absolutely we do. However, we should recognise that in the last year alone, Scottish Government funding has saw delayed discharges decrease by 18%. And we're still doing significantly better than we were in 2007 when the government came to power. So much to do, but still real progress made. And none of us should deny that, irrespective of whether the fact there's an election coming up or otherwise. Yes?
Dr. Simpson.
I don't deny the progress that has been made in the last year, but I think you must recognise, as Audit Scotland did, that in 7 of the 9 targets, things have got worse and are deteriorating. And in terms of the bed occupied days, the numbers were 20,000 in July 2011 in a month. There were 46,000 last month. So though there was progress in the last year, which I welcome, nevertheless, it's almost more than twice as bad as it was in 2011. That is not progress.
Mr. Doris, I can give you 7 minutes.
Thank you. I make the point, Dr. Simpson, that we're still doing substantially better than the Labour Party were when they were in management of Scotland's NHS, and when the Scottish Government has identified what issues are arising, they commit money and finances to invest in that, including £100 million over 3 years to tackle delayed discharge. That's how you manage an NHS. You keep a weather eye on it and you invest as where appropriate. So I think we've done a number of positive things in relation to the NHS, but I did want to say a little bit about, and I'm cutting some of those out now, because I want to say a little bit about the Vale of Leaving Hospital. I have to say, as a family member rather than as an MSP particularly, my mother was cared for in the Vale of Leaving Hospital with a terminal illness, and it was palliative care that she received in Lomond Ward. She got an exceptional service from the amazing staff that were there. Sadly, she's now passed away. I see the vital service that the Vale of Leaving provides to people. That's my hometown. I represent constituents in Glasgow, but that's my hometown. The emergency facilities that are there, I don't want to get into debate during this part of the conversation about who did what, where and when in relation to services, but the emergency services that are there, a number of my family members really value those. And I'm standing here as a member of the Scottish Parliament, but also as a family member saying that I am confident and committed that those services are remaining at the Vale, and people will just have to take that the way that I say that, as a factual statement, and not play politics on that. The staff do an amazing job in the Vale of Leaving Hospital, as they do right across Scotland's NHS. I had a list of, and I'm not going to use them because of time constraints, a list of things that I thought would improve in Scotland's NHS quite dramatically over the years, but with elections arising, the party of government tends to list all the things we think we've done incredibly well on, and the main opposition party says all the things they think we're weak on. When I was going to list all the things I think we've done very well on, it didn't just happen by accident. It was because of national clinical strategies. I hope someone in the Labour Party actually mentions this document at some point during the debate and meaningfully engages with it. There's lots in here about unplanned admissions to hospital, whether via accident emergency units, whether it's day admissions or bed admissions, and how that's going up and up and up, and how we have to do far more. I think one of the key things we have to integrate into the delayed discharge question and early intervention is much more closely aligning housing policy with health and social care policy. And I'm delighted that health and social care integration has finally happened under this government, and there will be lots of great initiatives coming forward. But I think the next step has to be really weaving that together with housing policies and giving those that are moving towards the end of their lives or are becoming less independent because of their frailties, real choices in that housing journey. For many, it will be staying at home for longer. For some, it will be sheltered accommodation or very sheltered accommodation. For some, it will be residential care. For some, the last weeks of their life, such as my mother, it will be in a hospital bed. That's how it had to be. But when we weave the fabric of our policy through health and social care and Scotland's NHS, I think we have to think more carefully about how we weave housing policy through that. It is mentioned in this document as well. The challenge for all parties after the next election is to make this a reality. And my one question I would have for the Scottish Government, I think this is a superb document. But at some point, be it 2 years, 4 years, 6 years, we're going to have to review how NHS boards have sought to align themselves with this document and make progress. And that's a challenge for us all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Doris. I can give members 7 minutes, but not a lot more. So Jackie Bailey to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much welcome the opportunity to participate in this debate. And let me say at the outset that the Vale of Leven Hospital is my local hospital, and I'm going to focus on that today. And I've spoken many times in this chamber about the challenging geography and the need for accessible local services, so I won't lecture you again on just the difficulty in accessing services in my part of the world. I think members will know that I will do everything in my power to protect the services there and will work with any government of whatever political stripe to do so. I'm equally not afraid to challenge any government of any political stripe in so doing. My local community have petitioned this parliament, we've held hands around the hospital, thousands have marched in the streets, and believe you me, we will do so again. The staff that work at the hospital are second to none. Their dedication and hard work is at the centre of the very positive experiences patients have at the Vale. So I do want to thank them for all that they do, but I want to acknowledge that, like many staff across Scotland, they're not resourced to do their job properly. Now, I welcomed very much the vision for the Vale at the time because it sought to provide stability and an assurance about services. I visited the Vale Hospital in the company of the First Minister at that time too. But you know, let's be clear that despite this, cuts at the Vale have continued. Staff numbers have been cut, bed numbers have been cut, clinics have been cancelled, community maternity unit hours reduced. The Christie Ward permanently closed and, as we speak, being demolished. Junior doctors' vacancies unfilled. And now Ward 6 closing with the agreement of the Cabinet Secretary. And then we had the leaked document in January this year about NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde's proposals to cut services. This was to make a saving of £60 million. And what were they going to cut? Staff numbers, bed numbers, emergency care at the Vale, community maternity units at the Vale, perhaps Inverclyde and the RAH, the children's ward at the RAH, and more besides. Now, the Cabinet Secretary was very robust in telling us that NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde didn't know their uplift for the new financial year, so we weren't to worry. Well, I can tell you that the Cabinet Secretary was wrong. They knew roughly the amount that they were due to get. And guess what? Now that it's all in the public domain and everyone knows their uplift, the cuts have gone up from £60 million to £69 million. So everything is back on the table and more. And when I have asked about the Vale before, because the Cabinet Secretary knows my interest in this, both she and the First Minister have talked about the past. She did it today. And I recognise and welcome what they have done for the Vale in the past. Let me put that on the record. But I want to talk about the future because that's what people in my area care about. I know we're going to be kept in the dark before the election and the cuts will be rolled out after. And just in case you're in any doubt about this, the Cabinet Secretary's amendment gives the game away. She deletes the part of the Labour motion that talks about retaining specific services. She substitutes it with warm words about hospitals. And of course, buildings do matter, but it's what's in them that matters more. And then we see the word safe before local services. And I want to tease that out a little because, you see, I'm told that if the cuts don't go ahead, then emergency and maternity services at the Vale will be deemed clinically unsafe, and we as politicians simply can't argue with that. It's openly talked about by senior clinical staff, by health board staff, by the government as well. Emergency care, the medical assessment unit, the minor injuries unit provide services for increasing numbers of local people. 1,000 more this year than 2 years ago. That's their central importance to what's delivered. But I also know that there are hundreds of thousands of pounds being spent on locum doctors because they can't recruit junior doctors to the Vale. So will she guarantee that this will continue? Because this is at the heart of concerns about safety. I want her to guarantee that whatever happens, she will retain all current services, including the maternity service, which actually hasn't been mentioned in any of the commitments that the government have made to date. I want that guarantee for at least the next 5 years, and a simple yes in her reply will do fine by me. And can I say to Bob Doris, who demonstrated the value of the Vale of Leven Hospital, this isn't about playing politics. This is about certainty for the local community that he grew up in, and I'm sure he will share my concerns to deliver that.
Absolutely. Bob Doris.
I thank Jackie Bailey for giving way, and I know she's got a track record in seeking to defend the Vale over the last few years, but again, I say this as a person who was brought up in the Vale. I think one or two locals in the Vale might occasionally accuse Jackie Bailey of playing politics over the Vale.
Jackie Bailey.
Can I say, I think the one thing that people will say, and it's not just a few years, it's 16 years. We have been having, you know, trouble at the Vale across successive governments. I'm the first to acknowledge that. But I think my local community would not deny that I am the one that's campaigned against any and all governments in protection of the Vale of Leven Hospital. Now, seasoned commentators will, of course, remember the care report. A specialist as necessary, as local as possible. That was the soundbite for the future delivery of our health services. And make no mistake, the soundbite might be different, but the national clinical strategy is actually the same. We all agreed with the care report. We agree with much that's in there. Bob Doris quoted some of what was contained in the national clinical strategy, and I'm happy to discuss that with him, because we talked then, as we do now, about delivering services closer to home, about shifting the balance of care, about using specialist centres. The same principles are in the national clinical strategy. But implicit in that will be disinvestment from acute services and changes to our hospitals. So please tell us now, tell us before the election, what services you will centralise, what services you will cut, and what hospitals will close. We shouldn't pretend about this. You really cannot say one thing in here and one thing to health professionals and another thing entirely to communities like mine. That would indeed, presiding officer, be beyond dishonest.
Thank you. I have been over generous with the first two speakers. I must now ask everyone else to keep to the 7 minutes that I have allowed. Stuart McMillan to be followed by Paul Martin.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm fortunate that I've not actually had to utilise utilise the hospitals very often in my 43 years. But I do recognise that I've got certainly a number of friends and family, as well as many constituents who have done. And I want to put it on record my thanks to every single person who actually works within the health boards and works within our NHS. They do a fabulous job. And over the last 10 years, there have been significant changes in Scotland's population and the needs and the needs and demands placed upon our health and social care services. And in 2010, in the Quality Strategy, the Scottish Government set out its strategic vision for achieving sustainable quality in the delivery of healthcare services across Scotland in the face of the significant challenges of Scotland's public health record, our changing demographics, and also the economic environment. And in 2011, the Scottish Government committed to integrating health and social care to address, in particular, the changing needs of our growing population of people with multiple complex needs, many of whom are older. And certainly we've heard some aspects in the debate today regarding some would argue legitimate questions about the future, but also, as my colleague Bob Doris highlighted, just kind of some of the party political nature of kind of the health debate. Now, certainly,
One of the things that has been consistent over the last couple of months has been the latest attempts to spread fear over the future of local health services. I certainly would argue that they are nothing short of just being a campaign tactic. Now, Jackie Bailey, a few moments ago, touched upon this, the NHS leaked paper. Now, I think there's a few facts that need to be put on the record about this leaked paper. Now, fact one, there are 7 Labour councillors on the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board. Secondly, it is and it was an internal discussion paper. Thirdly, it's not a definite proposal or set of proposals or an approved plan. Fourthly, the content hasn't been approved by the board or referred to the Scottish Government. And certainly none of the points in the draft discussion paper have been put forward to the Government for consideration. And finally, any formal proposals will need full public consultation and require Government approval. Mr. Paul Martin.
Paul Martin.
Presiding Officer, I'm not sure whether Stuart McNaughton has been given the correct briefing from his resource centre, but just to confirm, there are 27 members of the board at Greater Glasgow. 20 of them are appointed by the Cabinet Secretary for Health, just to confirm that for the record.
Stuart McMillan.
I'm not denying that, Mr. Martin, but what I did say is that there are seven individuals on it from representatives also from the local authorities, and also those 7 are from the Labour Party, that Mr. Martin will also be aware, and all 7 are Labour. So the second issue that I do want to touch upon is just in terms of the what was that, Mr. Bibby? Are you?
Mr. Bibby, if you wish to make interventions, please stand up to do so.
No, okay.
Continue.
Right, and certainly, I mean, it's kind of highlight just a couple of points. I mean, certainly it was the Labour Party who wanted to close the E&E unit at Inverclyde Royal Hospital, and it was under Labour that Inverclyde lost its consultant-led maternity unit. Now, but I do acknowledge that the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde did, however, publish proposals to change the community maternity units in 2008, but these proposals were defeated by campaigners north and south of the river, and also by politicians from north and south of the river, and this chamber as well. We actually, on one of the few occasions, we probably united to actually help defeat a set of proposals from that particular health board. Now, Jackie Bailey touched upon the Vale of Leven, and certainly history also shows that it was in 2002 that it was under Labour that the E&E unit was closed at the Vale of Leven. So in terms of the record of delivery, certainly under Labour, there certainly has been a negative record in terms of actually trying to assist the populations within the west of Scotland area. Now, certainly as an MSP since 2007, I've had a strong record of campaigning to maintain services at Inverclyde Royal Hospital. My position will never ever waver from that, and therefore I am delighted that this Scottish Government is delivering for health in the Inverclyde area. With the positive news for the new Greenock Health Centre of £19 million being confirmed, and also the £8 million confirmation of the continuing care hospital replacement for the Ravenscraig Hospital. The Scottish Government has a clear vision for the future of our NHS and will continue to take the right action to ensure that Scotland continues to have an NHS that we can be proud of today and also in the future. And latest figures show that staffing in the NHS again has reached a record high, with more nurses and more consultants working in Scotland's health service than ever before. And that's 11,000 more staff working in our NHS, and this number continues to rise. And this also reflects the record levels of investment in our healthcare services, with next year's NHS and social care budgets recently confirmed to be over £13 billion for the first time ever. Now, this Scottish Government's significant investment has provided a growth in the NHS workforce, to ensure people in Scotland get the high-quality healthcare they deserve. Now, I'm very much conscious that I've got to finish at 6 minutes. Signing off, sir?
Yeah, up to 7, but we're tight at that.
Okay, and certainly, in addition, this Government are building for the future with the recently announced rise of 5.6% in student nursing and midwifery intakes, the 4th successive increase in as many years. And the level and quality of care provided to patients has contributed to people living longer, along with continued advantages in diagnosis, treatment and care. And this Scottish Government is also integrating health and social care and have introduced a self-directed support, which is empowering people to live more independently. Now, looking ahead, Presiding Officer, there are various issues that will specifically impact upon the health resources available, whether it's the percentage volume of demand for healthcare and also the cost. and also with the resulted anticipated demographic changes over the period to 2030, as well as increased life expectancy. And these are certainly huge challenges that the NHS Scotland have to face. But in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I think every MSP, I'm sure, wants to ensure that their communities get the services that they need, delivered by the appropriate range of health and social care professionals working together more effectively. However, it's this Scottish Government which is carrying out far-reaching reforms to our health service and will continue to consult on how these can be further developed. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. Just to be clear, a generous 6 minutes for everyone, absolute maximum of 7. Now call on Paul Martin to be followed by Gil Paterson.
Presiding Officer, can I firstly make reference to particularly Bob Doris's comments and latterly from Stuart McMillan in respect of the scaremongering tactics that are referred to? Can I just confirm on respect of the Save Lightburn group, it is led by Jerry McCann, who has no political allegiance to anyone. He's a Parkinson's sufferer. He's suffered from Parkinson's for over 20 years now, and he made it clear at a public meeting that I attended on Monday that his commitment is to ensuring the future of Lightburn Hospital. And in fact, he said that he was concerned that some of the emails he was receiving were individuals were referring to the scaremongering tactics that were taking place. And he said it was an insult to his intelligence that people should refer to that, because what he's referring to, I'll bring Bob Doris in a second, you'll get your chance, but what he's referring to is a document that was prepared by a senior official, Katrina Renfrew, as I understand it, at the Health Board in Glasgow, a financial planning document which proposed at that time £60 million worth of cuts, but latterly £69 million of cuts. Now, that's the document that's been referred to. That's the one that is still on the table. I'll give way to Bob Doris. Perhaps he could explain in more detail this document.
Mr. Doris, if you wish.
Well, I'm delighted for the chance to give clarity to the comments that I certainly made earlier. Mr. Martin, I was not making reference to any campaign or campaign group. I was making reference to Labour politicians, though.
Okay, Mr. Martin.
Again, he's not referring to the specific Labour politician, but perhaps we could hear Bob Doris clarify that once again. But can I just also refer members to the members' business debate that I led in respect of Lightburn on the 20th of September 2011, just after being elected to the Scottish Parliament in May 2011, when the hospital was proposed for closure. And I was delighted to support Jerry McCann, the leading campaigner of the Save Lightburn campaign. And I did actually welcome the rejection of the Health Board proposal by the then Cabinet Secretary for Health, Nicola Sturgeon. It was one that I understand and I recall was welcomed by all parties in this chamber. And I actually give credit to the Cabinet Secretary for Health on that occasion for ensuring that proposal was in fact rejected. And, Presiding Officer, following this decision, myself and other campaigners met along with Jerry McCann, met with the then Cabinet Secretary for Health in 2013, Alec Neil, to discuss further investment in Lightburn Hospital. And at that stage, we were given assurances that Lightburn had a future and we could look forward to a rosy future, one that would be about developing that very facility. Now, Presiding Officer, given this background and the political commitments that were given in this chamber, and that's one of the points I'd point out to the Cabinet Secretary for Health, the buck at the end of all of these discussions takes place at the Cabinet Secretary for Health. That's where the Cabinet Secretary has a role, and that's where this is political, because it's for the Cabinet Secretary. I'll bring her in a second. But given this background, I was astounded that this financial planning document, page 8 of it, confirms that it says here, now this is not scaremongering, this is a fact. This is a document that was created by Katrina Renfrew, which it says that there is a proposal that there's a closure of Lightburn Hospital, that it should be closed. Now, Presiding Officer, does the Cabinet Secretary, and she can come in a second, not agree with me that it's a disgrace that this Parliament should be held in such contempt that the Cabinet Secretary for Health, the First Minister, takes a decision to advise the Health Board that she's rejecting the proposal, but despite that, during this parliamentary session, the Health Board come back and say they're proposing it for closure, Will she instruct him not to propose it for closure and to withdraw it from the financial planning document?
Cabinet Secretary Shona Roberts.
Well, I would remind Paul Martin what the Chair of Greater Glasgow and Clyde has said, John Brown. He said none of the contents of this paper have been approved by the Board or referred to the Scottish Government for consideration. This includes the reported closure of Lightburn Hospital or changes to the services provided by the Vale of Leven Hospital. And as I understand it, as the Chair, he did visit Lightburn Hospital to reassure the staff and patients about that.
Mr. Martin.
Presiding Officer, this document is a live document that's been considered by the Board. It includes in this document the proposal to close Lightburn Hospital. Now, I question her once again, why is she not instructing the Health Board that we've already taken a political decision, she's taken it, her predecessor took it, that Lightburn should not close? It was widely consulted on. Why, during the same parliamentary session, should we be revisiting this proposal? It shouldn't be included in the document in the first place, never mind advising us that it's not came to her once again, and she should instruct them accordingly. But of course, Presiding Officer, I would welcome some feedback from the Health Board, and indeed, the Chief Executive of the Health Board, Robert Calderwood, was invited to a public meeting that was held on Monday of this week, invited to by the Save Lightburn campaigner, Jerry McCann. He declined the invitation. Presiding Officer, this is an official who's paid £190,000 a year, and he can't take the time to attend a public meeting in the East End of Glasgow. Now, I raise the point, I look at Mr Calderwood's hospitality register, and it has a number of entries, over 5 pages long. If he can agree to a round of golf with Price Cooper and Waterhouse, then he can agree to attend a meeting in the East End of Glasgow to ensure. And actually, let's look at the health challenges that faces in the East End of Glasgow. For example, 30% of those who live there are more likely to die from heart disease, 38% are more likely to die from lung disease. And indeed, when you compare the statistics of those in the East End of Glasgow, we keep being reminded by the media and many others that you're more likely to live 10 years longer if you live in Bearsden and Mulgay, if you live in the East End of Glasgow. Then we should actually do something about these statistics. And the provision of the kind of services that are provided in Lightburn Hospital provide that very opportunity. Presiding Officer, I ask the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary for Health, to join me in this campaign, along with the Save Lightburn campaigners, a very clear message: hands off Lightburn Hospital.
Many thanks. Now calling Gail Patterson to be followed by Jim Hume.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. It doesn't feel that long ago since I was speaking on a Labour motion on health, and like the others before, it contains patchy research, if any at all, and the usual negative rhetoric that we are coming to expect from the Labour Party in Scotland. I've looked over, as mentioned, the motion presented today, and I hope to speak to some themes related to it, namely that we have a committed NHS, a safe NHS, and a local NHS, all delivered by a dedicated, hard-working staff. My constituency, like many others across Scotland, is blighted by many health concerns, one of the largest being smoking-related illnesses. However, I was pleased to read that the Scottish Household Survey 2014 indicated that 20% of the adults in Scotland smoke, which is a reduction of 3% since 2011 and represents the sharpest reduction in rates of smoking since 1999. And it's indicative of good progress towards the Scottish Government's target of reducing the number of adults smoking to 5% or less by 2034. I was also pleased to understand that levels of smoking in the most deprived areas also fell from 40% in 2010 to 34% in 2014. It would be disingenuous of me not to mention the range of action that we are all aware that has been taken to tackle smoking, including an increase in age restrictions on the sale of tobacco from 16 to 18-year-olds, an overhaul of the tobacco sales and display law, the establishment of the first tobacco retail register in the UK, a range of comprehensive awareness-raising campaigns, and record investment in NHS smoking cessation services. Surely.
Jim Hume.
also recognise my member's bill on banning smoking in cars with children present as part of Scotland's aim and goals that will help to reduce smoking in Scotland as a whole.
Gail Patterson.
I very much appreciate that intervention and acknowledge the work that you're doing, and I think it's good work and it should be supported, Jim. On a safe NHS, Scotland has one of the safest healthcare systems in the world, with a record low infection rates and internationally recognised patient safety programmes. I'm pleased that Healthcare Improvement Scotland, that's called HIS for short, are due to be given the powers from April the 1st to close hospital wards to new admissions if there are serious concerns about patient safety. What is more fitting from my perspective is, if approved by Parliament, the secondary legislation will take forward a key recommendation from the late Vale of Leven Hospital inquiry. The proposed changes to the legislation will strengthen the scrutiny in our hospitals and give patients the confidence and trust in the fact that their care will continue to be among the safest in the world. Hospitals are cleaner and safer under the SNP. There have been major reductions in the number of hospital-acquired infections since 2007, with cases of C. diff in patients aged 65 and over reducing by 86%, and cases of MRSA reducing by 87%. No mean achievement. Labour's motion highlights ensuring the continuation of current services, and I just want to provide a couple of local examples where, under the SNP, services are not only being continued but also improved. I earlier today asked about an update from the Scottish Government regarding the new Clydebank Health Centre and bringing that to fruition for residents in my constituency. It was with tremendous effort on the part of many that the Finance Secretary, who had no small part in this effort, was able not only to announce a new much-needed health centre in Greenock, but as part of a combined £38 million capital investment, that a new Clydebank Health Centre would be built, allowing the continuation of a community health service in Clydebank. A great outcome for two challenged areas, and you know, the idea that one was in prospect in the first place and the local politicians didn't fight among themselves where it should be placed was something that we should all aspire to do. With a good campaign, reasoned argument, we were able to provide one in each of these areas. That's good work in my view. The First Minister, just a few weeks ago, had the pleasure to visit Clydebank in my constituency and meet residents and workers across Western Bartonshire and beyond. There we had, from the First Minister, a statement confirming that the Vale of Leven Hospital is a vital part of the local health service in Western Bartonshire, and she will make sure it continues to be for many, many years to come. And that includes, I'll just be coming to you in a minute, Jackie, includes making sure emergency services are retained at the Vale. However, members of the party opposite would have missed the First Minister's statement or didn't want to accept it, as they were too busy outside Clydebank Town Hall asking the SNP to put kids before local cuts. How ironic and rich, coming from the Labour Party, who run Western Bartonshire Council, which is about to see the third teacher strike in as many months, and a party
in his last minute that, now.
And a party that pushed through the council cuts, a council cut of half a day a week education. That's right, a council cut of half a day education, but were forced at an emergency.
Point of order.
Point Jackie of order. Bailey. I think the member is misinformed. Of course, he would realise that it's SNP cuts that means that Western Bartonshire teachers are on strike.
The member will be well aware that that is not a point of order. Please continue, Mr Patterson.
And well, I'll give you
an extra 30 seconds.
Thanks very much. But we're forced. The council, the Labour Council, was forced at an emergency meeting of the council to reverse this dreadful decision. And that came about because the roof collapsed in on them from the outcry from the public. Presiding officer, I'm looking forward to 2016, but even 2017, so that the veil of leaving hospital is not under threat and never has been under the SNP. The only time it is and was under Labour, and it was salami sliced time after time to the situation that may have been cut. I commend the Health Secretary's amendment to the Chamber. Thank you.
Many thanks. Now call on Jim Hume, to be followed by Neil Bibby. Up to 7 minutes, Max.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I want to start by thanking Jenny Mara for raising this motion in the Chamber today. It has been a wee while since we've had the chance to talk about changes in our NHS, and of course I truly appreciate the hard work off the staff day in, day out, and I want to take this opportunity, like others across the Chamber, to thank them for their hard work. The Cabinet Secretary will remember well that I have also campaigned hard for community hospitals across the region and been successful in stopping closures for for some of those which were scheduled as the preferred option of some health boards. I think we would do a disservice to all our hard-working NHS staff if we didn't point out to some of the issues that make their lives difficult, more difficult at work, and present some obviously concrete plans to hopefully help solve some of those problems. I fully agree with Jenny Mara's statement. People and communities deserve fully resourced services in their areas. But what we've seen since the last time we've had the chance to discuss the progress on the NHS has been an increase, of course, in vacancies of nurses and midwives to the highest rate in 4 years, and allied health professionals and pharmacy staff also. And of course, increasing pressures in winter months on the emergency services that are causing thousands more to wait beyond the target treatments they're promised. So perhaps one of the most serious failings in some of the actions is really the aggressive way in protecting the NHS and the reduction of funding for those who act as the gatekeepers for that health service that we all hold so dearly, the GPs and, of course, our primary care services. And it's perhaps appropriate to maybe not give my words, but the words of the chair of the Royal College of GPs. They'll be more persuasive, the words Dr. Miles Mack said last month, and I quote, "General practice has been deemed to be dispensable in its current form. We have received reassurance after reassurance that further funding for general practice would be forthcoming until it reached a level appropriate to patient need. Instead, we witness a further reduction and an ever-increasing gap between funding for GPs and that for other areas of healthcare. Patients have every right to worry," unquote. So it's difficult to understand how the Cabinet Secretary can turn to face Scottish people and state to them that this has only added 35 GPs in the last 5 years, or that GP training places are only, at the moment, 70% filled, and that increasing need is going unmet in some of the most deprived areas in Scotland. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, the year-on-year cuts in the GP funding since 2009 have obviously real consequences and will only get worse. The Cabinet Secretary continuously mentions in her amendment the importance of local services, local delivery, and as much care as possible to deliver locally. Of course, we'd agree with that, but the track record shows that in 2014, over 100,000 patients travelled to a different health board to receive treatment. Not a different hospital, but an entirely different health board. Yeah, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course, that will include many people travelling to the Golden Jubilee Hospital, which is a national hospital for hips, knees and other procedures. Surely he's not going to criticise that.
I was going on to say that, of course, some of those are going to needed operations where the expertise is, but more than 800 patients have been told they can't get it because of capacity reasons. So when a ship's sticking on water, it's wiser to plug the holes and polish the door handles. And it appears that the focus of the government maybe has been on polishing the surface of the NHS rather than supporting the absolute foundations that those who work to actually hold the NHS together. When the number of children and young people seen for psychological therapies have seen the lowest since stats began being published, we must stop and wonder what's going wrong and how we can fix it. 6,750 children waiting for their treatment to start at the end of December. That's less than 1,300 seen in that very quarter. yet the government still pats itself on the back on the number of staff employed in the last year. While the gap between headcount in the secondary and while time equivalent is considerable, shows that more people is not always more patient time. Of course, I'll take an intervention from the
Of course, Mr. Hume doesn't tell the whole picture, Presiding Officer. He would hopefully concede that more people are being seen through child and adolescent mental health services now than has been previously the case.
Yeah. Microphone for Mr. Hume, please. Thank you.
Thank you. More people seen, perhaps, but there is a larger demand, and there has been the percentage of the NHS spend on mental health services is lower than it has been for many years. And also, we've seen a quarter of nurses and midwives, the largest staff group in the NHS, feel that there's not enough staff to do their job properly. So it is a serious issue, one that we can't be complacent on, and one that we have to address. It's a situation that risks having even less resources available for communities. It's dangerous and wise to plan closures at a time when the health services is under so much pressure and demand is on the rise. So I do back the call by Jenny Marra to ensure that current services are supported appropriately, and I don't know how anybody could argue against that. I would also like to remind the Chamber of the principle of the Scottish Lib Dems that enabling and supporting local and community resources to run the right services for their populations is a strategy that respects those communities and allows them to put people in the centre of planning and service delivery. But, of course, how can they put people in the centre of planning when communities are being threatened with closures of hospitals, wards and emergency services? So, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, telling communities they should be empowered to provide more resources locally and then allowing hospitals to shut down is pulling the carpet from under their feet, counterproductive, damaging and, of course, wrong. So Scottish Lib Dems will stand on the side of communities and people to make sure that no unwarranted and unnecessary hospital closures take place, and will continue to stand up, of course, for the rest of the NHS, and not least the right of everyone for access to the right therapy and, of course, at the right time. Thanks.
Many thanks. I now call on Neil Bibby to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, for the opportunity to speak in this debate on NHS services, including those at the Royal Alexandra Hospital in Paisley. The RAH is a hospital where I was born. As a child, I was a patient in the children's ward, and my son was born at the maternity unit last year. So I know from both personal experience and speaking to local families how important the services currently provided at the hospital are. For many people in the Paisley area, the RAH is the NHS and provides the services that so many of us rely on. So when vital services at this hospital are under threat, I will stand up for patients, staff and the local hospital. As members, as Paul Martin has said and as members will know, the service and financial planning for 2016-17 and beyond document drawn up by officials at NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde was leaked in January. This showed cuts of up to £60 million they would need to find next year. That's over £1 million a week because of underfunding from the Scottish Government. No one can seriously suggest that the health service is being properly protected if Scotland's largest health board is considering such drastic cuts. Like many people in the Paisley area, yes, certainly.
So when Labour asked for half of the resources going to health to go to social care, was that a mistake or was it not a mistake? Because you called for it. Do you still support that?
What we support is protecting the NHS budget. You've got a strange way of definition of protecting if £1 million a week of savings are going to have to be found in the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. Like many people in the Paisley area, I was shocked by the report's contents and deeply concerned that work on the proposals has been underway for some time. Proposals including closing the RAH Children's Ward, making changes to maternity services and transferring additional cases from the Vale of Leven to the already overstretched RAH. Unfortunately, when it comes to the RAH Children's Ward, we've been here before, back in 2011 and again last year. One mum from Paisley recently commented that closing the RAH Children's Ward would be devastating and dangerous. Talking about her son, she said, if her son was having a seizure, how would she get him to the new hospital if the roads are bad? She also rightly said, Paisley is the largest town in Scotland and the people here deserve their own children's ward. Another woman told the Paisley Daily Express recently, my son was in the children's ward too, and the facilities are second to none. We take it for granted. How can they justify closing such a facility? These are just two comments, but there will be many more right across the west of Scotland, because the children's ward at the RAH doesn't just treat sick children from Renfrewshire, but children in other areas like Inverclyde and Western Bartonshire as well. The impact of a closure would be felt across a wide area. Another deeply concerning issue is that the Health Board paper stated that work is already underway on a proposal to deliver service changes to community maternity units. I have to say to the Health Secretary that any downgrading or closure of maternity services at Paisley's RAH would be completely unacceptable. Also deeply concerning is the proposal to transfer emergency cases from the Vale of Leven to the RAH. I would share my colleague Jackie Bailey's concern about the impact it would have in Western Bartonshire, but also I believe it would have an adverse effect on the RAH too. The Health Secretary would be well aware that only last year she was forced to send in a crisis team to the RAH A&E department as a short-term measure to tackle problems with waiting times. As we've seen in recent weeks, many people are still waiting over 8 hours to be seen. It would be nonsensical and wrong to add additional pressures to the already hard-working and dedicated and overstretched staff at the RAH by adding more cases to their workload. The ongoing uncertainty over the future of the RAH services is deeply disrespectful and worrying, particularly for the families and NHS staff employed at the children's ward. The Health Secretary told the Paisley Daily Express on 16th of January that she would have the final say over any proposals. That's why I'm calling on the Health Secretary to provide adequate funding and agree with the Health Board to give a long-term commitment on the future of RAH services. If Shona Robinson gives that much needed investment and cast iron guarantee, I will be the first to welcome it, but I'm not hearing it. It's time for straight answers from the government. The government amendment doesn't even mention the children's ward, let alone giving a commitment to keeping it. Unlike the Health Secretary, I'm not in a position to take decisions, but I'm in a position to stand up for my constituents and campaign along with anyone concerned about the RAH. Thousands of people have already backed a petition calling for a stop to these proposals and calling for a long-term guarantee. They're also backing my call that the Health Secretary ensure adequate funding is provided to the Health Board so that these services can be maintained. These names will be with you shortly, Cabinet Secretary, and it's time you listen to them. The RAH cannot become a forgotten hospital. This government was elected on the promise of keeping health services local. They will have broken that promise to my constituents if these proposals go ahead. Presiding Officer, I will stand up for my local hospital and the vital services it provides every single day. As local health campaigner Jack Davidson has said, all we need is a commitment, a long-term commitment, that services in Paisley will not be affected and we would be satisfied. Until then, we will continue to campaign for that commitment. I agree with Jack Davidson.
Many thanks. Now call on John Mason. Can be followed by Neil Findlay. Generous 6 minutes, up to seven, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as we continue debating health this afternoon, I do think we have to acknowledge that health has been one of the best protected sectors in the Scottish Budget over a number of years. At the Finance Committee, we have had witnesses who have sometimes criticised this and have suggested that we could boost economic growth by, say, cutting health and putting more into house building or similar. So we are certainly not in a position where we need to be in any way embarrassed by the health budget. In fact, I think we can be very proud of the health budget that this government and this parliament has approved. Now, the motion itself clearly raises a range of issues, and I want to touch on some of these and also mention Lightburn Hospital, which is not in my constituency, but does lie close by and is used by some of my constituents. But the first theme I wanted to touch on was that of prevention. The Finance Committee over the last 5 years, and I think before that, before I was there, has spent a considerable amount of time on the subject of prevention and particularly preventative expenditure. Are we able to shift expenditure away from reactive spending and more towards an earlier preventative approach? There are many examples of what might be done in different sectors. For example, in justice, we spend more money on younger people and hopefully save later on in prisons. In education, we spend more again on early years and hopefully have less of an attainment gap in the teenage years. And so too in health, the question is, can we spend more in the community and less on hospitals? At a recent Finance Committee, I was ridiculed by colleagues when I suggested that part of me would like to close hospitals. But the serious point would be that if we are successful in preventative spending, then let me just finish this point. If we are successful in preventative spending, then we should need fewer hospitals. The difficult question, of course, arises on timing. Do you close hospitals first and use money saved in the community? Or can you spend on both the hospitals and the community for a period and hopefully close hospitals later on? I was interested to read in the Herald last week a front-page article focusing on comments by the ex-Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS Board Chair, Andrew Robertson. He was suggesting that Scotland has too many acute receiving hospitals. In fact, he suggests that there should be one hospital for 400,000 people, which would mean 12 or 13 for the whole of Scotland in place of the present 29. So at least this is a subject that we need to think about seriously. I'm happy to take an intervention.
Of course, I'll be listening to local people before I listen to the ex-board chair of the Glasgow Health Board. Can I ask John Mason to confirm, do you think Lakeburn Hospital should close, yes or no, at any point over the next 10 years?
John Mason.
I'll come on to Lightburn in a minute. I said I was going to do that, but first of all, I wanted to deal with this whole theme of preventative spending, which is also mentioned in what I thought was, again, a very helpful briefing from the RCN for today's debate. And if I can just quote a little bit from it, amongst other things, it says, what a community is used to in terms of the services it has close at hand may not be the service it needs for the future. And again, it says, it is also very worrying that the debate continues around acute services in isolation. If Scotland and her politicians are serious about moving care out to the community, then we need to see investment in prevention and a shift away from debate around single acute services. But clearly, the other side of the picture is that many people do have a very warm relationship with their local hospital. Public campaigns are easily started around any potential hospital closure, and politicians of all parties tend to latch on to these campaigns, especially before an election. Would it ever be possible for politicians across the parties to agree that we want to reduce the number of hospitals long term and that none of us would campaign to keep particular ones open? Well, I'm not sure that could happen, but I very much doubt it will. Now, to move on, as was suggested, and as I said, I would, onto Lightburn Hospital, which lies in Carntyne, just north of my Shettleston constituency. Now, in one sense, it is hardly a hospital at all compared to the likes of the Royal or the Southern, which are so huge, and it is very small in comparison and has relatively few beds. And much of its valuable work is with day patients, for example, Parkinson's. Now, I receive mixed comments about it from constituents. Some feel it is outdated and the resources would be better invested in GP practices or in keeping people in their own homes. But others are very supportive of Lightburn, not least because it is actually in the East End. It is easier to get to than Stob Hill and is basically smaller and friendlier. And I have to say, I do find it strange that with mental health beds at Parkhead Hospital also being phased out, we potentially have the East End of Glasgow with no major health facility other than GP practices and health centres. The south side of Glasgow has the modern Victoria ACAD and the north has Stob Hill. But the East End has nothing like that. And I do find that a bit strange given our health record is so poor, and that point is made by Parkinson's in their briefing for today. Stob Hill may not be in the moon, but in practice it might as well be. It is very difficult to reach by public transport from our part of the city, and at a time when we want people to take more responsibility for their own health, it seems strange to move the facilities we have further away. So I do find myself torn between Lightburn perhaps not being absolutely necessary in its present form, but on the other hand, the bigger picture is fewer and fewer health facilities in one of the least healthy parts of our country. So my question, and it is only a question at this stage, would be whether we need some kind of ACAD or other intermediate facility in the East End of Glasgow, some kind of care level between the GPs and the Royal Infirmary. So in conclusion, we see health benefiting from record levels of funding, but I think most of us are agreed there needs to be a shift to more preventative spend. And I do urge all the parties to take a long-term view and consider if we do need or can afford all the hospitals we have at present. Thank you.
Thank you. Now call on Neil Finlay to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thanks, President Officer. let me start by echoing the sentiments of others and pay tribute to the staff who work in our NHS, often going above and beyond the call of duty to look after us and care for us. And let me also declare an interest in that my wife is employed as a clinical support worker at St John's Hospital. My daughter, a student OT, is a weekend domestic there too. And they, like so many doctors, nurses and support staff I know, epitomise the care and professionalism and values of the NHS. But these workers don't want warm or patronising words. What they want is action, because they're under pressure like they've never been under pressure before. And in Lothian, that pressure is at breaking point. Through freedom of information, I've discovered how senior management at NHS Lothian are privately unequivocal about the source of these pressures and how decisions made by government are impacting on services, on staff and on patients. Papers I have in my possession talk of pre-existing financial pressures, recurrent cost pressures and how the NHS faces a growing demand with reducing resources. Delayed discharge and poor social care, in my opinion, the biggest scandal in Scotland's healthcare system, is exposed. In July 2015, the Chief Executive of NHS Lothian said that the position had deteriorated significantly in recent months, and that, amongst other things, this was caused by market failure in Edinburgh and the City of Edinburgh's council's budget deficit. Presiding Officer, let's pause and digest that assessment by the Chief Executive of NHS Lothian. He clearly states that the crisis in social care is caused by the marketisation of the service, exacerbated by serious financial pressures currently facing councils as a consequence of Scottish Government budget decisions. And it is resulting in persistent bed blocking, where space is grabbed wherever it is available, including patients being boarded in the oncology department at the Western General Hospital, also boarded in emergency areas and day surgery units. And let me read you this quote from NHS Lothian from July 2015. The position has deteriorated significantly in recent months, with an 80% increase in delayed discharge since March 2015, resulting in the highest number of delayed discharges since when? 2007. To operate efficiently, there is a requirement to discharge 85 patients a week. The current level is 40. Now, this is the Cabinet Secretary who said she would end delayed discharge, overseeing a crisis in delayed discharge in Lothian. And she shakes her head despite the evidence from NHS Lothian. You need to wake up and smell the coffee.
Cabinet Secretary.
Don't worry, Mr Finlay. I am always awake always taking action to address these issues. That's why, of course, we've funded an extra £2 million with Edinburgh City Council. I know he doesn't want to hear positive news about Edinburgh City Council receiving £2 million additional pounds to help to eradicate delayed discharge in the area. I can assure Mr Finlay that they absolutely are focused on doing that, and perhaps he could welcome that.
Maybe a little extra time, Mr
Finlay. In addition to this, we see operations cancelled, and this week the performance of A&E at St John's and the ERI, the poorest in Scotland. NHS Lothian now has an overspend of £26 million, with St John's Hospital having an £11 million maintenance backlog. The Chief Exec says the deterioration in the delayed discharge position is having a negative impact, resulting in cancellation of elective surgery, and in turn this is having a knock-on effect in having to purchase private sector support to meet treatment time guarantees, impacting on our financial position. The current position is not sustainable for any system, but even more so for one with its own capacity pressures. And according to NHS Lothian, 4,500 operations have gone to the private sector, and there is no infrastructure for delivering orthopaedics available. In addition to this, we see only last week one in four GPs in Lothian with closed or restricted lists. And after almost 4 years of inaction, the Children's Ward at St John's, subject to a paediatric review that puts its status as a 24/7 service under serious threat, closed to inpatients twice in 4 years. There is a huge concern now about its future. 8,000 people have signed a petition calling for it to be retained as a 24/7 unit. And public concerns arrogantly dismissed by the Health Board chairman, saying he wouldn't listen to them. NHS Lothian wanted that review to report as soon as possible because they said any delay to it could fuel further uncertainty around the future of the ward. And of course, we now know that that review was delayed until after the election, following the intervention of the Cabinet Secretary and her civil servants. And she cannot deny that fact. But, Presiding Officer, the plot thickens. This last week, I received the latest FOIs in relation to the paediatrics review. And the proposal to have a review, which threatens the provision at St John's, was made public in August 2015. But I now have evidence that on the 23rd of February 2015, 5 months before it was announced, NHS Lothian senior officials briefed West Lothian's two constituency MSPs, Angela Constance and Fiona Hislop, telling them there would be a Lothian-wide review. And yet, they said not a single word to their constituents. No press statement, no letters to the thousands of concerned local people. Nothing but a vow of silence because it suited them politically. And where are they today for this important debate? Presiding Officer, it's my contention that they deliberately kept this information from their constituents, knowing that there would be an outcry in the communities they are elected to represent. These two politicians have concealed what they knew from the public they are supposed to serve, and they have many questions to answer over this. I can assure you those questions will be asked.
Many thanks. Now, Colin Richard Lyle to be followed by Alison Johnston. 7 minutes of the
Thank you, please. Presiding Officer, and this is where it gets interesting. As a member of the Health and Sport Committee for many years, this topic is particularly important to me. I've always supported the NHS and this SNP government's efforts to safeguard and improve it. I personally remember Labour's plan to close Monklands Hospital A&E services during their time in power. Since the SNP came to power in 2007, these plans were halted. Emergency services at Vale of Leven Hospital and St John's Hospital have been maintained, and proposals to close Lightburn Hospital have been rejected. I'd like to point out that under this government, NHS staffing levels are at a record high. Additional 11,000 staff have been employed, an increase of 9%, including over 2,500 more nursing and midwifery staff. Number of GPs has increased by 7%, and investment in the services has as well. No, I won't. Additionally, the number of consultant vacancies has decreased. The future of NHS in Scotland looks bright, with a rise of 5.6% in student nursing and midwifery intakes, the fourth successive increase in many years. Also note that investment in the NHS under this government is also unprecedented. In this year's budget, an additional £500 million has been provided for health spending, giving a record total investment of nearly £13 billion. A £250 million new investment has also been announced to support the integration of health and social care. All territorial boards are receiving real terms increases in funding, with increasing number of patients and more complex illnesses to treat. This government has continued to support the NHS and ensure that it can meet the demands placed on it. There's been significant investment and improvements in primary care as well, with an increase in primary care fund and a 13% increase in spending on GP services. Scotland is recognised as having one of the safest healthcare systems in the world. This government has worked tirelessly to ensure that hospitals are clean and safe as they possibly can be. 2007 has been a major reduction in the number of hospital-acquired infections, with cases of MRSA decreasing by 87%. 100 inspections were carried out yearly by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, and that as of April 1st, they will have the power to close hospital wards to new admissions should there be concerns about patient safety. Social work and NHS staff now visit clients in their homes. Around 78,000 people in Scotland benefit from free personal care. Despite an increase in elderly population, the number of patients in care homes has fallen by 1,289 between 2000 and 2014. Expenditure on personal care services to older people in their own homes has risen from 158 million in 2004-05 to 364 million in 2013-14. This government passed the carers bill, ensuring they receive all the support that they need, and also announced funding for care worker training. Labour has charged this Scottish government with failing to tackle delayed discharge. However, compared with a decade ago, the number of delays, standard delays, is down by 62%. 62%. In December, delays were down by 18% compared with the previous year. Delayed discharge is clearly a priority for this government, as in 2015 it announced £100 million in funding to combat the problem. It's simply untrue that this government has failed to reduce A&E waiting times. In fact, they've improved significantly, with 94.9% of people being seen within 4 hours or less for A&E sites across Scotland this past December. Cancer patients are also receiving faster treatment. The worst performance under the SNP government was 91.5% in the first quarter of 2014. However, this is significantly better than Labour's best performance of 84.5% in the quarter of 2007. By a final quarter of 2014, 94% of patients were treated within the 62-day standard. Furthermore, the government has not neglected mental health. Under the SNP, funding for mental health has increased by almost 40%. Since 2009, the number of clinical staff working in child and adolescent mental health services has increased by 28%. No, I'm sorry, I don't have time. The government has announced more than £54 million to improve access to mental health and launched a £15 million Mental Health Innovation Fund. Public health has improved tremendously, with a decrease in the number of smokers, alcohol-related hospital stays. Prescription charges have also been abolished to the benefit of many low-income families. Finally, the premature mortality rate is now 19% lower than it was in 2016. I'm sure everybody's enjoying all these statistics. I am. To conclude, the Scottish people are extremely happy with the NHS, the recent survey. 89% of Scottish patients see overall care and treatment was good or excellent. Furthermore, there's a 21% increase in public satisfaction between 2006-13 under the SNP. As I have said before, and I agree with Jackson Carlow, the Labour Party needs to stop using our health service as a political football and stop talking it down. Our health service is well funded, well resourced, and we should be proud of it, and its hard-working staff. I have no doubt this SNP government will continue to work to ensure the people of Scotland receive the best health care possible, free of charge. Thank you.
Thank you. Now call on Alison Johnston, and after which we'll move to closing speeches. A generous 7 minutes, Ms Johnston.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's universally acknowledged that the NHS and our network of social care services in every local authority is an incredible national asset. And I too acknowledge the contribution of all those NHS staff, our GPs and our carers. They really are at the heart of this service. But funding too is absolutely key. And Greens will set out our long-term fair and progressive tax proposals within the next 2 weeks. And this morning we welcomed the government falling in line with the budget proposals Greens made during this budget on vacant land, a fairer council tax and ending the council tax freeze. But of course, as colleagues have mentioned, the most cost-effective measures are those which prevent ill health in the first place. Addressing poverty and health inequality is paramount. Well-being must be at the centre of government policy, because being healthy is not simply about not being sick. And this focus on a truly healthy life starts before conception, by supporting the growth of community-based projects like the Pregnancy and Parent Centre in South Edinburgh, a welcoming, not-for-profit organisation that works with parents-to-be and their families, by supporting organisations like the Serenians, who work with those who find themselves homeless or in a vulnerable position. We increase our national health by supporting local authorities to provide free fruit and practical food education through growing schools, for example, and by working towards free school meals for all primary pupils. I do welcome the progress being made in some of these areas. Physical activity is key too, and we can make it easier for our young people to be active by investing, as the Institute of Public Health directors urge, 10% of the transport budget on walking and cycling. This would ease congestion and cut air pollution too. Air pollution is causing over 2,000 deaths each year in Scotland, yet action by this government to address this invisible killer is dangerously slow. We can encourage physical activity too by working with local authorities to create exciting outdoor play spaces in our schools and more affordable access to sports facilities, which are prohibitive for many. Presiding Officer, we have to address poverty and inequality if we want Scotland to be well. When over 200,000 children live in poverty, and the Institute for Fiscal Studies advise us that this will rise by 100,000 due to ongoing austerity, we have to use every means at our disposal to mitigate the impacts. And I'm hopeful that we'll use the powers coming to this Parliament to do so, at least in part, for example, by abolishing benefit sanctions. And while we focus on reducing these health inequalities in Scotland, we need to focus too on ensuring that we work with all those delivering healthcare to enable them to continue to deliver the high standards of care that all in Scotland should expect. A living wage plus for carers is important. And we've heard that bed blocking is costing us a fortune. Every week in Edinburgh, some 5,000 hours of social care go unmet. This has to change. And a focus on primary care is essential, as 90% of patient contacts are with GPs and other primary care professionals in our communities. So we have to act to ensure adequate training, recruitment, and importantly, retention of GPs, as the world is very eager to recruit our well-trained medical professionals. I welcome the relationships being built across parties by the BMA, the RCGP, the RCN. And last night, I was pleased to take part in a debate on public health with cross-party colleagues and the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health Scotland. Now, the manifestos of these organisations leave us in no doubt as to their experience-based and well-evidenced views on how the government and this parliament can help improve health outcomes in Scotland and deliver the broader national consensus that Jackson Carlaw spoke of. Engagement between clinicians and this parliament and the public is essential and welcome. And as we've heard, public meetings are taking place this month as part of a review of inpatient hospital care for children in NHS Lothian with a deadline of the 18th of March. Now, the independent expert review is being undertaken by the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health, who've been asked to do so by NHS Lothian. But all our citizens, young and old, are entitled to safe, effective and sustainable patient care. With the increasing birth rate and West Lothian's growing population, it's essential that paediatric services at St John's are protected and properly resourced. The West Lothian population is expected to increase by 25,000 within the next 19 years. This isn't the time to diminish services or to centralise them or to ask people to travel to services in Edinburgh, for example, where the National Record of Scotland estimate that population growth is set to outstrip previous growth forecasts, with an expected increase of more than 28% over the next 25 years, including a 27% increase in children under 15. Andrew Burns, the council leader in Edinburgh, rightly notes that this growth, which is not far off a one-third increase in the population, comes with massive challenges. A future-proofed health service with facilities as local as possible is essential in dealing with this challenge. Now, the Cabinet Secretary has assured Parliament that there are no proposals for closure, but nor is there a guarantee, for example, that paediatrics at St John's will not be downgraded or closed. Delay and uncertainty cause unnecessary stress for patients and staff, Staff concerns led to a downgrading off the ward last summer and a reliance on expensive locums and increased overtime requirements. It demonstrates the need for a fully resourced plan for the future. And there's understandable dismay that the people of West Lothian won't find out until after the election what the future holds for them and St John's. And I would ask the Cabinet Secretary and NHS Lothian to take every step to ensure that this report is published before the election. In closing, Presiding Officer, we have a duty to all to do all that we can to improve Scotland's national health. And in order to do so, we must invest in and properly support all those who look after us, whether at home or in our hospitals. Thank you.
Many thanks. And we now move to closing speeches. But before we do, can I just invite everyone who's taken part in this debate to return to the chamber, particularly front bench spokesman Jackson Carlaw. 7 minutes. Mr. Finlay.
I'm just a bit confused. During the course of the debate this afternoon, we've had extended time and we had opposition member following opposition member. I'm just wondering, I'm confused, is there a reason for that? Surely it's not because the SNP members didn't take up their speaking slots this afternoon, was it?
I don't believe so, Mr. Finlay. I don't think it's a point of order. The speaking order is a matter for the presiding officers. How members wish to use their time is a matter for them. But I will reflect on what you say and perhaps speak to you privately subsequently on this matter if you wish. I now call on Jackson Carlaw. A generous 7 minutes, Mr. Carlaw.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start in summing up by going right back to where the debate began with Jenny Mara's opening speech. And the part of her motion which I think both the amendment agrees with as well, and that is the tribute that is paid to the NHS staff. Because in this National Clinical Strategy for Scotland, some of the decisions that will require to be taken are extremely far-reaching. And they will depend upon there being the widest possible engagement of all parties concerned, not just in this chamber, but within the wider NHS. And I do think there are issues here for the government that they'll need to give some consideration to. And I refer specifically to the NHS Scotland staff survey of 2015, which looked at employee engagement. And it measured in the survey by five standards, whether people were well informed, appropriately trained and developed, involved in decisions, treated fairly and consistently, provided with a safe environment. And as far as involved in decisions was concerned, the statement then went on to say, this is including staff in organisational decision making, has the potential to obtain valuable new opinions, ideas, solutions. It can also promote trust in the organisation and their sense of ownership and responsibility in respect of the changes made. Well, it must be a concern then that of the 29 prime questions which were then posed to NHS staff, there was a negative index change on 17 of them. There was no change on 8, and there was only an improvement on 4. And whilst the Cabinet Secretary said it's vital that we learn from these findings, I mean, I think it is significant that of 5 standards, 2 were up and 3 were down, as was the overall experience of staff within the NHS in 2015. Now, that is not an encouraging background if you are looking in the next Parliament not just to pay tribute to staff, but to carry the staff with us in the difficult decisions that require to be made. And I think I do ask the question of the Cabinet Secretary. Given that there is an understanding that there is a difficult series of decisions to be made if we are to secure the future of the health service in the next session, how does she envisage harnessing any non-partisan, cross-party potential that there is in this chamber to the effect of arriving at a strategy upon which we can all agree? Because my concern at the moment is that while there have been some perfectly productive individual discussions, they're not necessarily informed or harnessed in a way which I think allows the political parties in here to feel that they are meaningfully contributing or being included in a strategy that I think we could all unite behind. And I think that is a potential weakness. And secondly, I think it's terribly important that this assessment by the staff within the NHS in 2015 is addressed and reversed, because if they don't feel that they are part of that progressive understanding of the changes that are taking place, then we will see building in that a resistance, and potentially that will exacerbate some of the fears that can be raised and have us being diverted onto conversations which are actually totally unhelpful. Now, I don't say any of that to dismiss, and I thought there were some very powerful contributions this afternoon in respect of some of the hospitals that are mentioned in the Labour motion, particularly the Lightburn Hospital, and the fact that it is the only facility in the east of Scotland, and all the attention and support it received in this Parliament in 2011 and 12. I think there's one other thing that isn't really touched on in this National Clinical Strategy for Scotland. And it is a sense that sometimes there is a kind of ball of cotton wool that embraces the National Health Service, almost a little bit like a Soviet-style bureaucracy. And we need to find a way to overcome that. Can I illustrate it thus? My mother has been in the new Queen Elizabeth Hospital for the last 2 weeks, so I've been there more than I might have expected. It's a fabulous facility, let me say. I know it has issues in its accident and emergency area, but beyond that, I have to say I've been very impressed. But I was contacted yesterday by a gentleman from the hospital who phoned me up and said, we need you to come in tomorrow, Mr. Carlow, or tonight to complete our next of kin patient questionnaire. And I said, well, that's really going to be very difficult because I'm unable to get there across tonight. I said, have you a next of kin who can do that? I said, no, I actually don't. I said, would it be possible to complete the survey over the phone? Well, it's very unusual, but I will ask. So he went, when he came back, we are in business. The highest levels have approved me asking you these questions over the phone in relation to my 85-year-old mother. Question number one, is your mother pregnant? I said, well, not to the best of our knowledge. Question number two, has your mother got gunshot wounds or any bullets lodged inside her person at the present time? I said, not so far. And I only say that not really to... I understand that these questions have to be asked of various times and places, but I'm sure it strikes a chord in the minds of most members that there is still within the NHS a sort of cumbersome bureaucracy that sometimes seems to stand in the way of common sense. Given that my mother was in the hospital at the time and I thought quite obviously wasn't suffering from gunshot wounds, my sister did say she should ask for a pregnancy test just to be sure. But I do think that rather ludicrous way of illustrating the point, I hope, touches a chord with people that there is sometimes a kind of layer of something that if we are going to have the health service as efficient and as effective as it can be, also needs to find some way of being addressed. It is a weakness of such a large monolithic system. Presiding Officer, I finish where I began, and that is really to say that there obviously are day-to-day management issues and concerns and pressure points, staffing issues, all of which I think it's perfectly legitimate for us in this chamber to tackle the government on and to ask what their solution and issues and approach to those will be. Sometimes I worry that the government's answer to those points is to worry more about the headline the next day than it is necessarily to tackle substantively the underlying issue that the particular pressure point statistic or piece of information has revealed, and that is a weakness. But on the general strategic approach to the future of Scotland's health service, we need to find a way of working together, and if this is the government that will lead us in the next Parliament, they have to tell us how they intend to achieve that, rather than just by diktat, but by consensus, a genuine consensus involving all the politicians in this Parliament.
Many thanks. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison, a generous 9 minutes.
Okay, thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start with Jackson Carlow, which in his opening speech was a very constructive tone, and welcome his support for the National Clinical Strategy. I will make it my personal business to have a look at that questionnaire, because you make a fair point about sometimes things are asked even though it doesn't make much sense to ask them, so I'll have a look at that. Bob Doris gave a very moving speech, and his personal testimony about the value of the services at the Vale, particularly the palliative care provided to his mother, I think reminds us all of how important those services are. He also made a fair point too about the need to align housing policy with health and social care, and that's a point well made and one that I believe has been taken on board in the new world of integration. Jackie Bailey quite rightly paid tribute to the dedication and hard work of staff, and I agreed with the principles of the vision for the Vale, and that is to be welcomed. In terms of the position of junior doctors, I think it's very important that services at the Vale and other hospitals remain a good training environment for junior doctors, and I fully support that and will continue to support that. I don't believe Jackie Bailey has, if she has read the National Clinical Strategy, then she perhaps needs to read it again, because it's very explicit about the key role of local hospitals, very explicit, and indeed is very explicit about delivering healthcare as close to home, indeed in the home of people where that is possible. And when it talks about specialist services, it is very clear as well that what they're talking about is, well, first of all, the requirement for hospitals to work together on networks to overcome some of the recruitment and retention issues that we face, but also that those specialist services we're talking about are the once or twice in a lifetime type of services that people are willing to travel for to receive those services. I'll let Jackie Bailey come in.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention. I think she would acknowledge it's not just hospital buildings, it's about what services are in them, and that's the concern of my local community. And therefore, can I press her on whether she considers the emergency care and community maternity services delivered at the Vale of Hospital just now to be clinically safe? And does she anticipate that anything will change? My fear, let me be honest with her, is that decisions are made by clinicians that we as politicians can't challenge. And my fear for these services is that unless, you know, Glasgow gets to cut them, they will be deemed clinically unsafe.
The services across the NHS in Scotland are all clinically safe. And we wouldn't be providing services that are not clinically safe, and that is kept under constant review, and I would want that reassurance. But let me be very clear, the vision for the Vale is very clear on the services that are core to that vision. And emergency care, and I've said this to Jackie Bailey before, the value of emergency care at the Vale this winter was there for all to see. You only need to look at the figures of the number of people that were seen at the emergency facilities within the Vale, and they have a very unique setup, as Jackie Bailey knows, around the levels of patients that can be seen in the medical assessment unit is actually quite a high level, and they only transfer patients when that is required. So, you know, I have said time and time again the value of that to the west of Scotland. Hospitals are very important indeed. Can I welcome Paul Martin's welcome for Nicola Sturgeon's decision back in 2011 to keep Lightburn Hospital open. He made some very important points about health inequalities in the East End of Glasgow, which I absolutely fully agree with him on. But of course, as we've said, the difference is that Nicola Sturgeon had a proposal in front of her to close Lightburn Hospital. I have no such proposal in front of me to close Lightburn Hospital, and indeed the board have been clear that no such proposals have been approved by the board, not least to come to me. Very briefly.
Well, Paul Martin. Just to clarify, and all I'm asking the Cabinet Secretary to do is to ensure that the decision taken by the then Health Secretary, Nicola Sturgeon, is adhered to. It was only taken a few years ago, and already the Health Board are back saying they want to revisit it. Tell them to think again.
As I have said time and time again in this chamber, there would have to be a clear material change from the position in 2011. I don't see what that material change has been. There would have to be a material change to the position in 2011. I have said that to Paul Martin in this chamber. Gil Paterson quite rightly welcomed the investment in the health centres in Clydebank and Greenock, and of course reiterated the First Minister's commitment made to the Vale of Leven at the Clydebank Town Hall meeting. Jim Hume, I want to just make sure that he understands, which I'm sure he does, the investment that we are making in primary care services, an additional £85 million over the next 3 years in mental health, an additional £150 million over the next 5 years. And of course, within that, the mental health element for primary care is around £10 million because we recognise very much that we need to do more within general practice and primary care to support mental health services. Neil Bibby mentioned the RAH, and again, I would pay tribute to the staff in the RAH and the A&E performance of the most recent week ending the 21st of February was 92.4%. Now, it's not 95%, but that's not a bad level of performance given where the RAH was last year. So that hospital has dramatically improved its performance at the front door of its hospital, and that's something I thought would be welcomed. Neil Findlay mentioned a number of issues about Lothian, and I want to just make clear that NHS Lothian's resource budget is going to increase by 6.3%. An above inflation increase, and of course in addition to that they will be a beneficiary of the accelerated movement to parity, so that they will get £14 million of additional NRAC funding as part of the 2016-17 settlement, and in addition to that of course there have been allocated resources to tackle delayed discharges and an additional allocation of resource for social care. And in terms of the delivery on delayed discharge, I can tell Neil Findlay that as of January 2016, as of this January, there were 131 delays over 3 days. That compares to 255 back in October 2006-07, 76 delays over 2 weeks compared to 204 in October 2006-07, and 47 delayed over 4 weeks compared to 160 under the previous administration in 2006-07. So yes, we have more work to do, but of course Neil Findlay will not recognise any of the progress that has been made. And in terms of increasing capacity, of course, as we announced last year, we plan to spend £200 million to create a network of 6 centres for elective surgery across Scotland. 2 of these centres will be based at St John's Hospital and the Edinburgh Royal Infirmary. But, of course, Neil Findlay is never one for welcoming good news. Can I say to him, I think we've heard enough from Neil Findlay today, quite frankly. Can I say to Alison Johnson that I absolutely recognise some of the issues she raised around the need for more preventive work. That's why, of course, the National Clinical Strategy focuses very much on the role of primary care, on the role of the community health hubs, bringing services together, not just in the statutory sectors, but, of course, in the voluntary third sector as well, because they have an important contribution to make. And I'll just finish on this point, because I see time is against me. Throughout this debate, we've heard Labour members complain about the resources to the health service. Well, we have record resources to the health service. We have a real terms increase. At no point during the budget process did the Labour Party come forward and ask for more money for the health service, and indeed supported 50% of it being given, quite rightly in my view, to social care services. So yet again we have an example of the Labour Party coming here and saying one thing and then saying a completely different thing the next day or the day after that. You need to have a more coherent vision and policy for the health service. Otherwise, why should anybody take you seriously?
Many thanks. Now calling Dr. Richard Simpson to wind up the debate. Dr. Simpson, you have until virtually 5 o'clock.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by making what will be probably my last declaration, referring to my declaration of interest as fellow of the two colleges, members of the BMA and a number of other medical organisations. And can I thank Jackson Carla for his kind remarks in respect of myself and on behalf of Nanette Milne, who are the two remaining medical members in the unit. Colleagues, I'm going to depart from my usual summing up, in which I refer to a lot of different members and try and address the issues they've raised. And if members will indulge me, I want to really look at a sort of report card on the NHS over the last few years. Can I start with where we are in consensus? And that is that we have a commitment shared by all the parties in this Parliament to the continuation of what Scottish Labour did in departing from Labour in England. In asserting that we have an NHS in Scotland that is a traditional public service based on collaboration and cooperation and not on competition and opening commissioning, which includes the private sector. And that's a major statement from the entire Parliament that really discriminates us from the rest of the United Kingdom. I think the second thing I want to say is that there is an entire agreement across all the parties of the absolute need for health and social integration. If we don't have that, as Audit Scotland said, we'll need 6,000 more acute beds, and that's something which is bad anyway, but we can't afford it. So we need the health and social integration. And that was tried under Labour. We tried with our Joint Futures Programme, but it has now needed legislation, and hopefully the new IGBs, the Integrated Joint Boards, will actually deliver this. Now, I'm also recognised many of the good things that have been done by successive governments since the Parliament opened. The introduction of new vaccines, for example, meningitis, HPV, rotavirus, shingles vaccine, all these public health measures which will improve the health of our community. I welcome the world-leading approach to hepatitis C because with the new treatments, Scotland is world-leading in this, and indeed Tayside is leading within that world-leading system. This is an enormous advance and one to be welcomed. I welcome the fact that the SNP have continued, extended and deepened the patient safety programme. I think that is absolutely vital, and we need to recognise that there's been a 16% or 17% reduction in hospital mortality, and that's extremely welcome, and also the reduction in premature mortality.
Doris?
There are two reasons for intervening. First of all, is to pay my tribute to yourself. And the contribution you've made towards health in this Parliament in my much shorter time here than you've been here. But secondly, one of the areas you've been involved in with the Health Committee as well on a cross-party basis is really developing a much better system and access to new medicines, and it is an example of what we can do on a cross-party basis in relation to achieving that. And I'll pay tribute to the role Dr. Simpson's played in relation to that also.
That particular aspect demonstrates what happens when the parties work together within the committee system. But I have to say that there are many other areas, reduction in stroke, reduction in cardiovascular disease, reduction in suicides. And as Gil Paterson and others have said, there are other areas of improvement which I acknowledge. Reduction in smoking levels, especially in adolescents starting, reduction in alcohol consumption. However, the rest of my speech, Deputy Presiding Officer, is going to be presenting the other side of the problem. Because my central concern is that the SNP government are very good about talking up the things that they do well, and that's entirely appropriate, but they fail to recognise quickly enough when things are not going right. Jack Sancarlo actually made a very good point in his summing up speech about the staff's attitudes in that survey, because that reflects where we're at. We're on a descending curve in terms of morale within the health service. And if we don't recognise that, if the next Parliament doesn't recognise that, then we're in real trouble. So let's look at some of the things where we haven't made events. We've got the highest number of drug deaths of anywhere in Europe, and yet the ADP budgets are being cut by £16 million unless the health boards give them that money. And that money of £16 million is within the increase that's just been announced. It's not an increase. It's actually a cut to the ADP budgets. And I can tell the Cabinet Secretary, my conversations already with a number of ADPs indicate the boards are subjecting them to substantial cuts. Big cuts in Edinburgh, for example, on staffing. What about obesity, which is the other big public health issue? Well, the report card on that reads, slow progress, limited success, requires more effort. That's not me. That's the report of the Obesity Action Plan. The level of obesity of people overweight and obese is 65% in Scotland. And on children, it's 68%. That cannot continue. Life expectancy in Scotland will reverse if we do not tackle that problem. So that's an area which I hope the next Parliament will address with great seriousness. The SNP are very good on aspirations, and we share those aspirations, but they must admit when things are not going well. So they came to power attacking Labour on hidden waiting lists, introduced a highly complex new waiting time system, and were then faced with a scandal in Lothian in 2011 because of gaming. Well, I have raised the issue of the fact that the social unavailability in Glasgow is now 1 in 3 of all patients. That means 1 in 3 of the citizens of Glasgow, when presented with an appointment, say, I can't make it. Now, there's something wrong with an appointment system that does that. I'm not saying there's gaming, but there's something going on with that, because it's much higher than Lanarkshire, which is a fairly comparable board. Now, the second prong of attack of the SNP coming into power in 2007 was not to cut hospital beds, and 15% of those beds have gone. We can debate whether that's appropriate or not, but nevertheless, that was a manifesto promise. The third prong of attack was closure of local hospitals, and much of our motion today and the debate, which you've heard from colleagues on my side of the chamber, on our side of the chamber, has been about the uncertainties around the failure to make clear statements on some of these hospitals. Now, we know change is going to occur. Without change, we cannot survive. But on the other hand, delaying reports or having prolonged reports on St John's paediatric unit is not acceptable, because planning blight causes doctors not to apply for jobs there, which then makes the thing less safe, and it will be closed perhaps on safety grounds. And it's interesting that the government's amendment refers to safety as part of that. Then we come to delayed discharges. And of course, the SNP members talked about the progress over the last year, and I welcomed it. I got up and welcomed it. But nevertheless, it is twice as bad as it was in terms of bed occupied days in 2011. So we have to accept what the Audit Scotland says, which is 7 out of 9 targets missed and the situation deteriorating. Because unless we start with an honest debate, then we can't actually adopt the clinical strategy and try and drive it through. Yes. Now, I very much welcome the fact that we are talking about bed occupied days, because of course, if people stay in hospital over 6 weeks, that's a very bad thing. But on the other hand, the bed occupied days strongly affects what's actually happening. Let's look at another promise. The predecessor, Nicola Sturgeon's Cabinet Secretary, promised that every board would look at boarding out and we would try and tackle that. And yet there were 130,000 patients boarded out in the last 2 years. And there are two boards aren't even the capacity to report on boarding out. Now, if they don't have the capacity, how is the board in that area even beginning to look at that particular issue? Since 1999, we have been driven by targets. And targets have served this Parliament extremely well and served the health service and our citizens extremely well. But I have to say to colleagues that that is something that will need to be looked at and addressed, because some of the targets, I think, are now causing considerable clinical problems, perhaps at the margin to begin with, but they are part of the reason why, as Jackson Carlow said, the staff morale is actually dropping. The particular one that I want to draw attention to is the legal requirement that everybody have their inpatient and day case treatment dealt with within 12 weeks. Colleagues, we passed that bill in 2011. I warned at the time that I thought that was not a good law. 100% target is radically different, as Paul Gray said to the Health Committee, to a 95% target. The marginal costs of that 100% target to the health service are absolutely massive. Absolutely massive, because if they can't use the Golden Jubilee, which is expensive for the boards, they then have to use the private sector. And I have colleagues who are praising the government for this target, because on the back of treating bunions and other small things, they are actually getting great holidays in the West Indies. Colleagues, if you give somebody a legal guarantee, then it is a legal guarantee in law. 32,000 patients have not had that legal guarantee met since it was put into practice in December 2012. And the target has not been met once since the law was passed. That is a bad target, and it needs to be looked at again. Now, in the few minutes I've got left, I want to refer to a couple of other things. In terms of the increase in staff and comparisons to 2007, I have to say to the Cabinet Secretary that we've got 5% more population than we had then. And that's reflected, for example, in general practice. Every GP, the number of patients per head of GP has gone up by 10%. Every GP is dealing with another 500 patients. That is a huge number. A huge number for it to go up. It's a 10% rise. And this has been seen, and Jim Hume referred to it in his speech, about the GP crisis. That was not recognised for a long time. I warned about it in 2010. I said we needed a new contract then. Nothing happened. We've now got the new contract going to come in. It will not be a salvation, I have to say. And the situation is we've got 500 GPs empty, one in four practices in Edinburgh, one in four practices. There's no patient choice. They have to go to the patient allocation system to be allocated to a practice. One in four have restricted access. And we have patients queuing on a Tuesday morning at 8 a.m. in the morning to be the first 30 to be accepted by a practice. This is not acceptable. This is simply not acceptable. We have a crisis, and unless we admit that and accept it, then we are not going to make advance. I will finish, Deputy Presiding Officer, by mentioning two other things. One is dementia. When 50% of our dementia patients with a diagnosis of dementia are admitted to hospital and it isn't recorded on their notes, how can we manage dementia in hospital? That's a huge challenge for the acute sector, but it's not happening. That is a Scottish research paper based on Scotland. Finally, we have all failed to tackle health inequalities. They've actually got worse since the Parliament was founded. It's all parties, all governments' fault, and it needs to be addressed in the next election. Health is a fantastically challenging portfolio. My one regret, as I've said, that despite the fact we share a vision on 2020, we can share a vision on the new clinical strategy, that the SNP government too often denied problems over the last 7 years, waited until they were inescapable, then threw a little bit of money on it. That is no way to govern. We have to have a common purpose, a common agreement on the way forward, and if we do that, then this Parliament, which I will watch from afar, with great interest, may begin to solve our problems. We have a world-leading NHS in Scotland, but unless we actually do that, we will not maintain it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Simpson. That concludes the debate on health. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15773 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15773.
Formally moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 15773 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of seven Parliamentary Bureau motions. I'd ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motions number 15774 to 15780 on approval of SSIs en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Question on these motions will be put in decision time, to which we now come. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is amendment number 15766.1 in the name of Shona Robertson, which seeks to amend motion number 15766 in the name of Jenny Mara. On health, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 15766.1 in the name of Shona Robertson is as follows. Yes 76, no 42, there were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 15766 in the name of Jenny Mara as amended on health be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 15766 in the name of Jenny Mara as amended is as follows. Yes, 75. No, 43. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed to. I propose to ask a single question on motions number 15774 to 15780 on approval of SSIs. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected to a single question being put. Therefore, the next question is that motions number 15774 to 15780 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of SSIs be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motions are therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.